I literally had the gentleman that gave me the evidence, and this guy, if you knew who he was, I promise you, you'll know that this guy is as serious as a heart attack. And for this guy to tell me that, you know, he personally has experienced his bank vault being emptied, the laboratory where he was having testing done, people showing up in suits, taking the material. We're renting a B-25 next month, and we're going to do a recreation of his encounter. But it's spectacular. I mean, it's exciting. It's dramatic. They ended up at treetop level, and he had, I think, three or four engineers from Lockheed and Allison Engines on board that all just sat there looking at this disc. Basically, what it reconfirmed for me was that there have been official inquiries at a very high level of government, of President of the United States, right down to the signing of an executive order to release classified files 25 years or older, which would fall into the category of a lot of UFO events.
Welcome to UFO Radio International, investigative podcast show about UFO phenomena. And here is your host, Giuliano Marinkovic.
I have prepared something exceptional for my listeners. I was able to interview yesterday filmmaker James Fox on the phone while he was on his route from San Francisco to New Mexico while he was driving. And the reason why James is traveling there is because today he will film a very important person there in Santa Fe for his new documentary. Anyway, I was arranging the interview with James for several weeks. James is in an extremely busy schedule. As you know, he is in the middle of the production of his new documentary with title 701. And that number represents the number of cases from the Project Blue Book, the official study of UFOs that was conducted by the Air Force from 1947 up to the 1969. And these 701 cases remained unexplained from more than 12,000 cases that were investigated at the time. So this was the best time window where I could get to James. And we agreed to go for 30 minutes. And I'm calling this exclusive 30 minutes with James Fox. And he has such a busy schedule now, and it's not easy to get to him. But again, I have a background with him. We discussed some cases in the past. We exchanged material. We were corresponding. So I want to thank James once again for his kindness and for allowing me to interview him in this extremely important and busy time for him. There is a lot of sensitive information that we discussed. So this episode was produced for more expert researchers and that have deep background in the field. So I will just give advice to pay attention and to read between the lines, because you will be able to hear essentially important information. And I think some of these sources and contexts that James has established will point to some new historically important information, especially this whole situation regarding the Holloman landing film and case related to Robert Emeniger and Alan Sandler. You will be able to notice that there is one new moment there. And again, we only had 30 minutes and I actually had 9 pages of notes, but I think I was able to get through to the most important questions that I prepared. Again, if you want to learn more about the career of James Fox, I discussed that extensively in the interview from 2011 that I recently published. And you can find it in our archives. So this is a follow-up interview, companion piece to that one, with new, updated and very important information. So in a minute, James Fox, 30 exclusive minutes regarding his deep sources and contacts. Stay tuned. Thank you. Today is November 26th, 2017, Sunday, and after 6 years, I'm speaking again with James Fox. James Fox is an investigative filmmaker. He directed and produced several documentaries. Regarding topic of UFOs, he is known and respected for 3 documentary films on the subject, which are UFOs, 50 Years of Denial, Out of the Blue, and I Know What I Saw. In 2007, he organized an event with help from journalist Leslie Kane. For that particular event, James Fox assembled 14 speakers, including 2 retired generals and several other military officers, a former governor, civilian pilots, and government scientists from 7 countries: Belgium, Chile, France, Iran, Peru, UK, and United States. As I said, that event happened in 2007, and there, first-hand testimonies of encounters and investigations with UFOs were presented. In the end, testimonies from that event were incorporated into documentary I Know What I Saw. James, previously we discussed back in 2011, where we covered your National Press Club conference. We covered that pretty extensively. And also we talked about I Know What I Saw, your documentary. We talked about your career. So I think that period of your life is covered in our previous interview. So I would like now to move from 2011 and what was happening after I Know What I Saw and what has initiated you to start to work on new documentary about UFOs again that had at the time working title 701. I'm not sure is it still the actual title, but so you can talk a little bit about that step.
Yeah, well, you know, it's funny, you know, they say never, because every time I've finished a UFO documentary, and remember we did a couple of versions on Out of the Blue. We had an early version, which we spent another 2 years on, and then we had sold that to NBC Universal, and then 3 years later, I owned the rights again. I revisited that film and spent 2 more years on it again, which totaled 7 years in total for Out of the Blue. And the point I'm making is I kept saying I'm never going to do this again, and then, you know, one thing leads to another. It ended up, you know, with I Know What I Saw, and then after I finished I Know What I Saw, I was absolutely knackered. I remember I was just so spent. Even down to the point where trying to make deliverables to get the film on the air, and you're just done. I mean, you're like a flat tire, you know. And I said, I'm never doing this again. Like I'm finished. But in the back of my mind, I always felt that I could do better. I always felt that I didn't quite make the mark. You know, I felt like I had failed on getting a theatrical release on this topic. I've always felt that it was something that could be potentially done, because it's one of the few topics that's done amazingly well in on the big screen, you know, with E.T. and Close Encounters of the Third Kind and MIB and all this stuff. That done right, I always felt like it could be very successful, but I just kept failing at it. So I pushed the UFO phenomenon aside after I Know What I Saw. And I worked on a film on the BP oil spill. I remember just being frustrated when it got to day 30-something. It was just unrelenting, spewing raw crude into the Gulf of Mexico. I thought, my God, you know, grabbed my camera, went down to the Gulf, raised some money, and did that film called Pretty Slick. But just as I was approaching the end of that film project, I got contacted by Tracy Torme, who I guess had seen, or maybe his wife had seen, I Know What I Saw. It was repeated on History Channel, and said, oh, there's this really good film, and you've been an advocate for UFOs and government transparency for so long, and I never really believed you, but I saw this movie, and it really, I really saw, you know, your argument. And so Tracy, as a result of that, reached out to me, and he said, you know, I wasn't going to touch this with a 50-foot cattle prod ever again. But I saw your film, and I read Leslie Kane's book, and I thought, you know, I've always wanted to do the seminal documentary feature-length film on the topic of UFOs for a theatrical release, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, quite honestly, I've always wanted to do that as well. I said, how would you like to team up? And so that was the birth of 701. And I've gone through a few partners since then, but I've always clung on to the initial concept. And I had about a year and a half, 2 year downtime period where I became a father, and you know, just it took some time to get some traction again with funding, but a number of things happened and the stars lined up, and the film will be done probably in less than a year from today. And the partners, the new partners I have, are the partners that I've dreamed of having for ever since I've started this project, ever since I've started making documentaries on UFOs. That is that they're not only a means, but they also give me free rein. They don't get in my way at all. And they have access to people that I've never experienced the level of access. So it's very exciting for me. It's just very exciting for me because I'm finally in a position where I've got, you know, the funding. Now, is it just a massive check where I can go do? No, not quite. But it definitely, you know, I've got to be, you know, cautious with, you know, what I can do, but it's there and I'll get the film done. The film will be done. And it's wonderful. It's a great experience. And I'm really excited. We were shooting it. I've hired professional cameraman, one guy from National Geographic. It's the best thing that ever came out of that hokey TV show I did. I met a great friend who's a fantastic cinematographer. Hired professional audio and lighting people, so it looks like 60 Minutes or Frontline, that level of production quality. Really beautifully shot and internationally shot. We've been all over the world. I guess got back from Africa and Australia, possibly doing a case in China as well. And then meeting with high-level, you know, military and government officials from around the world as well, and having unprecedented, including here in the States, access. So that it's going great, man. And I really think that people are going to be pleasantly surprised having waited this out with me on the end result.
Absolutely. I think you are in such a unique position. And like you said, due to the investors, I think even in 2013, you started to offer a reward for evidence, for documents, any kind of physical evidence for people if they are willing to step out to you. And and even regarding, like you said, from chasing UFOs, you took the best you could. You ended up with David West, the cinematographer, right, who is helping you too.
He's with me. He's with me right now. We're actually going to do an interview in Santa Fe tomorrow. Yeah.
That's so great. Regarding all these unique situations, I'm very interested in one particular story that is connected with Robert Amenegger and his documentary UFOs Past, Present and Future from 1974, when they got really extensive access by the Air Force with the military personnel documents and so on. And during the production of this documentary, Air Force and Pentagon offered to filmmakers Alan Sandler and Robert Amenegger the military film which allegedly shows the landing of a UFO in the Holloman Air Force Base. During the production, Robert Amenegger also met Colonel Weinbrenner, who was at the time, during the 70s, the head of Foreign Technology Division in Wright-Patterson Base. And I was so fascinated when I learned that you were part of that story, that you were in touch with Amenegger and even later with Sandler. So maybe we can go deeper into that, because I think it started by the deathbed statement by Colonel Weinbrenner. And in that deathbed statement, Colonel Weinbrenner sent a message for filmmaker Robert Amenegger. And the message basically said that the spacecraft crashed and that three bodies were recovered and they are kept in underground facility in Utah. And you were
deathbed statement. Well, you know, you'd hear about these, you know, oh, there were secret meetings with, you know, ETs and President Eisenhower. And I just think, yeah, right. And I think that story stemmed from the potential landing case at White Sands, New Mexico, in the 60s, reportedly featured in the documentary you had just mentioned with Alan Sandler and Bob Emanager. And when you initially hear it, as proposed, and remember that in that film, every word was carefully scrutinized by the military because, as you well know, those two had unprecedented access to military bases and people, personnel, during the production of that film. They had unbelievable cooperation. So for them to mention that landing with the alleged ETs coming out and all having been filmed as an event that either may have happened or already or could happen in the near future, you kind of almost kind of have to read between the lines. But then, you know, once you start looking into that further, you know, there was the I'm trying to remember the guy's name. I'll think of it in a second. But he was the
Paul Shardle.
He was at Norton Air. Paul Shardle. Thank you. He was at Norton Air Force Base, and I came across some articles written by Coral Lorenzen, right? APRO, I think it was.
Yeah.
When I was investigating the landing of Socorro, and of course, you know, White Sands is a stone's throw, Holloman is a stone's throw from Socorro as the crow flies. I started reading some, you know, rather credible articles and references and eyewitness testimonies that were written in the 60s about a landing that occurred there as well. Then I got Paul Shardle's statement, and then I met with Emanager, and I talked to Alan Sandler, and then I thought, wow, I really think this landing did actually occur, and I actually believe that the UFO incident at Holloman was possibly filmed. And I've talked to one person who's seen the film, whom I believe, and then, of course, you got the video statements of Paul Shardle talking about it. So I think that event probably occurred, and it probably did get captured on film. I know it sounds pretty out there, but I think as a way to debunk the whole thing, they seeded the story of Eisenhower meeting with aliens in the desert, and then one can only look into that and quickly debunk that whole thing, which would dismiss the Holloman Air Force Base account. So I actually believe that it possibly did happen, as reported in the documentary. And, Alan Sandler, it's such a long story. I'm trying to give you the truncated version. But Alan Sandler had basically, you know, said that he was shown the footage, thinking it was some sort of test vehicle or mock-up of an alien invasion or something of that nature by Paul Shardle. And that the very next day, military higher-ups came down and put the clamps down on the whole thing, and he didn't even tell Bob Emanager for 4 years that Paul Shardle had shown the footage. But he described the footage, and it's funny, actually, because when I want to really absorb every single detail of an event that somebody either experienced or saw, I close my eyes. And when I talked to Alan Sandler about him having viewed this footage of the landing, I closed my eyes and I listened to every word so carefully so I could recreate the whole thing in my mind. And I did that. And I think that, and he was shown the footage and they were debriefed. So I think that, again, I think that whole story with Eisenhower meeting with aliens in the desert was created so it could basically debunk that whole thing. So I think that film footage exists. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, and I do recall when you were speaking about it, when Alan called you, you stopped your car when he said that he actually saw the film. And I think this is actually huge, because for years, Emanager was the one who was giving interviews. He was speaking about everything. But, oh my God, finally you got to the Sandler, and he now actually told you that he saw the film. Now we actually have the confirmation that the film physically existed. So maybe...
Yeah. Alan is convinced that what he saw was something that was created. It was a flying saucer that the military was flying. So I interviewed Colonel William T. Coleman. I think he was the public relations officer for the Air Force at the time, and he's also in the film. And coincidentally, I interviewed him for our movie, and he's going to be in the opening scene of the whole movie. His encounter, that's another story. But I said to him, look, you know, Alan Tanner claims that this is what he was shown. Did the Air Force have anything like what he describes in their possession at the time? He said, absolutely not. It's like, okay, well, did they fake, you know? No. So Colonel Coleman wouldn't confirm that that was a legitimate UFO landing that was captured on camera, as well as the occupants getting out. But, you know, Alan Sandler definitely saw it. He said it wasn't created in the studio. And Alan just thought, he described even the way the thing came down and wobbled. As he said, just like in the sci-fi movies, a seamless door opened and dropped down and these guys came out. And he described the headgear. And the interesting thing was, I believe that he said it was shot from one angle on a tripod. So they were anticipating the arrival of this thing. Enough time where, you know, you could get the tripod out, right? Because as a cameraman, you don't just happen to have a tripod right there as a UFO comes down and lands. So it seems like they were either waiting for it or knew it was coming or something. And why not? I mean, a UFO landed, you know, just, what is it, a year? I don't know if it was a year before or a week earlier. I don't know. April of 64, it's a core of New Mexico. So why not have Coleman, and why not have cameras that they could have filmed it? I mean, why not?
Yeah. And he also described you the look of these so-called entities, and what we saw in the actual documentary of Hemenegger is the visualization of that film. So maybe can you talk a little bit about these descriptions that Alan told you about?
Yeah, he just said that two of them came out. I believe the two that came out were a little bit smaller than the third one, and that they had tight-fitting suits on, and that they had long, really big noses, no chin, slits for mouths, vertical slits for their eyes like a cat, and they had some kind of headgear, and then some kind of what he thought might be an interpreter that they were holding in their hand that it could speak into and it would translate. So, but again, he was speculating. You know, I don't know. That's what it looked like. That's what he told me. He said two flanked the exit of the craft, and that the third one came out and met with military commanders, and I think he said got into a Jeep or a military vehicle and then drove off and left the disc sitting there on the ground with the two guys flanked on the exit. That's what he said. Yeah. But he described the way it was coming down. He felt like maybe it was in trouble or something, the way it kind of floated down. It was kind of wobbling as it came down, which is, you know, I've heard that so many times from my witness accounts. I'm not sitting there saying definitively that that was an alien spacecraft that landed at Holman Air Force Base that was captured on film, but that's certainly what it seems to have happened. Do you know what I mean? And yeah. Alan is not out there trying to sell his story or go on camera and talk about his story. Hemenegger knew that the film exists, believes that the film exists. Hemenegger knew Paul Sartle. Paul Sartle swore up and down this film footage existed. Paul Sartle showed it to Alan Sandler. Hemenegger just happened not to be there that day. And Paul Sartle got the green light from Colonel Coleman that these guys would be coming, to go ahead and give them full access and cooperation on this UFO documentary that they're making. So I guess that film had just been recently processed, and Paul thought it was okay to share it. So, you know, it's kind of one of those situations that slipped between the cracks, you know?
Exactly. And like you said, of course, we will never know, but based on these testimonies, obviously something was there. They were giving them this film like a sort of a bait, so they would join and go deep into the project. But again, at the last moment, the film was pulled and taken back by Pentagon. And I can tell you actually, James, that thanks to you and to your interview that I heard, I actually contacted Sandler myself, and we spoke off the record. But I can tell you that what I know now is in sync what you just told me. So I'll not go deeper to that. So thanks so much for that. And I also know that you were speaking with Hemenegger and Sandler regarding this Vandenberg footage. And allegedly that film shows a launching at Vandenberg Air Force Base, and where cameras were following a missile. And at one moment, two white objects came into frame and started to track the missile. And that film was offered to Robert Emenegger and Alan Sandler to be used in their documentary UFO Past, Present and the Future that they were preparing at the time, but it was never incorporated in that documentary in the end. So yes. I'm wondering, have you been able to get it for your movie?
He said if I came up with, it was either $20,000 or $25,000, I can't remember, that we would put it in an escrow account and then he would show me the footage, and if it wasn't everything that he swore it would be, then I could get my money back and walk away. That if it was what he said it was, then I would get the footage. So I, you know, very difficultly, I raised that money. It wasn't easy because the guy who was putting the money up wanted to see the footage. So it's kind of hard to go, well, put the money up and then we'll show you the footage. Like the guy's going, why isn't this guy just showing it to us? But Alan's kind of weird like that. And so we finally raised the money. I think it took him like a year and a half, maybe 2 years. And Alan got cold feet. So I'd say that any of your listeners that want to reach out to Alan at this point, to please hold off, because I'm going to be meeting with him again in January or February, and I've got somebody who's now part of our project, who's got a lot of weight behind them, and we are going to approach Alan in probably February. We're going to actually go meet with him, and if anyone can get Alan to cooperate, it would be the guy that I'm talking about. I can't mention his name. So I'd please ask everyone to hold out, because I don't want him to get cold feet again. But he has arranged for me to be able to meet with him in either January or February of next year.
Oh, that's absolutely great. Okay, thank you so much for this evaluation of that whole story. It is absolutely amazing. Great that you are still working on the film. Now, during the production of your movie, of course, you met so many people, so many sources, and I was also fascinated by another story where you were contacted by a very respected physicist from California who also gave you some evidence, right?
Yes, yeah, but I can't talk about that.
Okay. No worries. Yeah.
Yeah.
We will wait for...
I'm sorry.
No worries.
I swore up and down I wouldn't talk about it publicly right yet. So, but yes, that is true.
That's
the
great.
The source of which is incredibly reputable. Let's put it that way.
That's absolutely amazing, too. I think also there are some cases where you were contacted and somehow these people simply... aborted their contact or something weird was happening, especially where you were investigating Virginia case from Brazil, which is related to alleged UFO crash in 1996. Fascinating case.
Yeah, boy, you're paying attention.
Yeah. Where you were...
Well, yeah. Well, it's funny, actually. I realize now I'm just like so naive, thinking you can put out an amount of money and then people will contact you and you'll just go and get this great evidence. But, you know, and you get a lot of baloney. I mean, there's just no question that, you know, and you know that going into it, but there's always, you know, the possibility, right? And you can tell when someone's pretty serious that they've got what you're looking for just by, it's usually a pretty relatively terse response and to the point, you know? And I had a couple of those. I think it was one in the States and then one in outside of Virginia, outside Sao Paulo. I don't remember the exact location. Mm. It was kind of like, you know, I've got what you're looking for, you know. And I made arrangements on two separate occasions for, you know, obviously to follow up and go meet with these people. And then I realized, and they just vanished, gone, like just went off the face of the world, which is really weird. Then I thought, you know, I've met with enough witnesses with tangible evidence. These things have a mysterious way of disappearing. And I know this sounds, you know, like I'm some sort of paranoid conspiracy theorist here, but I can assure you that after enough times of hearing these stories firsthand, including world-renowned physicists in the field, I'm absolutely convinced that there's some government agency monitoring, you know, social media and telephone and text messages and emails and all these things. I'm absolutely convinced this is happening. And I've been told, you know, I should be doing this via snail mail. So what I'm telling people now is, if you're serious, write me a letter. Tell me what you've got. We can meet in person, because I'm just being paranoid.
Obviously, you recognize the pattern after all these contacts. And I think this Brazilian guy that contacted you, he claimed he has pictures from Virginia case, right? Something like that.
They said that it was something like, oh, we've got what you're looking for. You know, it was like, there's no question. And I actually sent a Brazilian guy to go over and meet with him. Just vanished. And so, well, you know, you can imagine that if there were military people involved with that recovery operation, that those people would be closely monitored. Well, I mean, I would. If I was the military, I'd be monitoring them for fear of them talking or meeting, you know what I mean? So all it takes is for them to, you know, send out an email or a text message saying, hey, I've got what you're looking for, to a bonehead like me, and they're going to come down on top of them. I mean, why wouldn't they? I would.
Yeah, especially if you are dealing with evidence that is sort of on strategic level that could really shake up the so-called knowledge that we currently have about this phenomena.
Exactly. Any kind of official photograph. And I've actually told research, I literally had the gentleman that gave me the evidence promise me, and this guy, if you knew who he was, I promise you, you'll know that this guy is as serious as a heart attack and as credible as the heavyweight intellectual in the field of ufology. And for this guy to tell me that, you know, he personally has experienced his bank vault being emptied, the laboratory where he was having testing done, people showing up in suits saying they're from his organization and taking the material. He's like, I'm not just being paranoid. I'm telling you for a fact from personal experience that this stuff will disappear. You do not talk about it on anywhere publicly. You don't tell anybody where it is. You don't do any of those things. And so, you know, I'm like, okay, I won't.
Yeah.
And, so I don't know what government agency is monitoring this stuff, but somebody is.
Yeah, but they're
doing their job.
yeah, and you are doing your investigative job really in a great way, and also you landed interviews with Colonel William Coleman and Robert Friend, who was a head of Project Blue Book, and Coleman is now unfortunately dead. I think you had the last interview with him, and can you talk a little bit about these discussions?
Yes. So it was before the film project even was officially launched. I kept telling this investor, we have got to go to Florida and get this guy on camera. I couldn't do it fast enough. I was terrified that this guy was going to take his story to the grave. And I got the funding and I flew to, and before we didn't have a name for anything. It just went poof. I called it Operation Archive, went to interview Colonel Coleman and got his story on camera. And of course I hired David West. I mean, it looks like 60 minutes. I mean, it's absolutely stunning. And he talks about the most dramatic UFO encounter I've probably ever heard from a pilot. We're actually one of the few dramatic recreations that we're doing in the film is we're renting a B-25 next month. And we're going to do a recreation of his encounter. But it's spectacular. I mean, it's exciting. It's dramatic. They ended up at treetop level. And he had, I think, three or four engineers from Lockheed and Allison Engines on board that all just sat there looking at this disc, performing maneuvers that unlike anything could perform back in 1955 over Alabama at treetop level, with no exhaust ports, with no wings, no visible means of propulsion. I mean, they're all just like gobsmacked by this experience. And I think the sighting duration was about 9 minutes. And again, I think he had to take evasive action at treetop level at maximum continuous power in a B-25. Super exciting, super dramatic encounter. And the interesting thing is that, you know, he said they landed the airplane and they were all debriefed, and finally, of course, Blue Book was in full swing there. It was 1955. And the people that debriefed them and took detailed statements, reports from all the eyewitnesses, was shocked at how consistently, they were all saw exactly the same thing. They all reported exactly the same thing. And then Colonel Talbot said when he was put in charge of Blue Book, public relations for Blue Book, or spokes officer for Blue Book, one of the first things he did was go to find his report. And, of course, you know, report a very unambiguous encounter. I mean, the very definition of unambiguous encounter from very qualified observers, you know, pilots and engineers. And, of course, that their encounter was not even part of Project Blue Book at all.
Yeah.
So that's interesting. And, you know, it's interesting as well as I interviewed, I guess I could tell you this now, what the hell, General McPeak. He was head of the entire United States Air Force, four-star general, Joint Chiefs of Staff, briefing the president every whatever. And it's funny, actually, I said, look, General, can we talk about a hypothetical kind of situation? And I recount Colonel William Coleman's sighting. And if this an event like this did occur, and we went through the, the sighting together, if an event like this does occur, and I had the head of the entire United States Air Force said it would be an issue of national security, and therefore would remain classified. So, you know, it's interesting. No one talks about the reasons for secrecy, like why would they anyway, you know, but the Air Force doesn't look at it that way. They look at it, if you've got an unidentified that you're unable to identify, then you'd have to, you know, consider that as a potential threat, and that threat would be, that incident would be classified as a result. So it's a very powerful statement from a very powerful, influential, you know, military general right at the beginning of the movie that kind of makes a bold statement about the whole phenomenon and potential reasons for secrecy, which I think that the general public needs to hear. Because they don't look at it like the way that the public would look at it, like, oh, philosophical implications of contact. It's not, to them, it's more like a problem, you know?
And thank you so much that you read my mind, because after the Coleman question, I was just preparing to ask you about McPeak. So thanks so much for that.
Yeah. No problem. Yeah, we were very lucky to get that interview.
Thanks so much, James. And I also know... also, the Coleman's interview, that was historically important one, because from one point of view, he was spokesman also for Pentagon and Blue Book, and now he was going more explicitly out. And I also know he was preparing a book with Robert Friend, and now, of course, he died, and unfortunately, we will never know how much further he wanted to go. For the end, because we have limited time, I just wanted to ask you about John Podesta, who was a chairman of Hillary Clinton's presidential campaign, and of course, he was a chief of staff of President Bill Clinton's administration. I know you also have been able to land the interview with him, which is, again, extraordinary, so maybe you can give a little bit something about that, if you can.
Yeah, I know that one kind of slipped out. I wasn't really talking about that one, but you know, basically what it reconfirmed for me was that there have been inquiries, official inquiries at a very high level of government of President of the United States, right down to the signing of an executive order to release classified files 25 years or older, which would fall into the category of a lot of UFO events, including Roswell, and that the president and his cabinet were not satisfied with the answers they were getting. In other words, they were the military was not forthcoming, and I had that confirmed to me 110%, which is kind of, you know, what we've always sort of suspected, but you know, it's hard to imagine that the president would be given the runaround, but it does make sense if you think that, you know, an elected representative would come into office and suddenly be privy to 70 years of classified information, only with the idea that in 4 years or at the most 8, be back out on the street as a citizen. I could see the reasons why they wouldn't debrief the president. And I don't know who the last president was to have been in the know. But yeah, so that was pretty enlightening. And
And I do know you talked in the past that you had pending interviews in mind, like Harold Brown, Secretary of Defense, even Nancy Reagan and so on. Bill Clinton through Symington, maybe, who knows? So do you have any progress on these sort of pending ones?
So we've had I can't say with who exactly, but we have established contact. And some of these people have acknowledged what we're doing, and participation is under consideration.
That's great. James, we said 30 minutes, so I'll not take a minute of your time. Thank you so much. I'm calling this 30 exclusive minutes with James Fox. I'm so happy that I talked with you again after so long, and I'm following your work, respecting you so much, and man, thank you so much for what you are doing. I mean, I think this movie could really be a game changer.
I really hope so. And I appreciate your support so much. You've been so good to me over the years, and I really appreciate that. You know more than I do.
Well, depends. Thank you once again, and all the best luck and all the best wishes for your new interview that you will have tomorrow in Santa Fe. Take care, James. Happy traveling and good driving. Okay?
Oh, thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.